In this video, we will demonstrate a commonly used method to measure the minority carrier lifetime in a crystalline silicon wafer. We will start with a short introduction of the minority carrier lifetime and how it is related to the excess charge carrier concentration and generation. Secondly, we will demonstrate the typical photoconductance setup and the measurement principle to obtain the characteristic lifetime of the silicon wafer under test. Finally, we will discuss two operation modes of the setup that can be chosen based on the minority carrier lifetime range. First, we will recall the concept of carrier lifetime. The minority carrier lifetime is the characteristic time for the minority charge carriers to decay back to thermal equilibrium concentration after excitation. This decay will be facilitated through different recombination mechanisms that we have described in the PV energy conversion course. Mechanisms contributing to bulk recombination are radiative, Auger, and Shockley Retall recombination. Surface recombination occurs through defect states at the boundaries of the crystalline silicon lattice. The effective minority carrier lifetime, tau f, is the lifetime that is measured being the sum of the inverse of each component lifetime. It is therefore a measure for the quality of the bulk crystalline silicon material and how well the surfaces of the wafer are passivated. When we want to quantify the effective minority carrier lifetime, we will look at the ambipolar transport equations, here shown for electrons being the minority carriers in a p-type crystalline silicon wafer. When the wafer is illuminated homogeneously and without an electric field present, the equation is reduced to this form, where d delta n over dt is the time derivative of the excess electron concentration, g is the carrier generation rate, and r is the recombination rate. For low-level injection, this recombination rate can be expressed as the excess electron concentration divided by the effective minority carrier lifetime, since the lifetime is interpreted as the overall time that an excess electron can stay in the conduction band before recombination. We can now express the effective minority carrier lifetime from the following equation. From this equation, we can conclude that by measuring the electron density as a function of time, we can work out the effective lifetime tau f. The larger the excess electron concentration and the slower the drop in this concentration, the larger tau f. Now that we know how the effective carrier lifetime is related to the charge carrier concentration, the generation rate, and the recombination rate in the crystalline silicon material, we will introduce a lifetime measurement setup that is often used for determining the minority carrier lifetime of crystalline silicon wafers. A typical lifetime testing setup consists of a stage for the wafer with a flash lamp mounted at about 50 centimeters above the stage. This stage is connected to an oscilloscope or fast sampling data acquisition card and controlled by a computer. The principle of the measurement is to generate the charge carriers in the wafer by a very short and high intensity light flash. As a result, the photoconductance of the wafer will increase. A coil that is located underneath the wafer sends electromagnetic waves into the silicon. This coil will sense the change in conductance of the wafer, resulting in a change of the impedance of the coil. This signal is measured through an RF bridge circuit. The setup can operate in two different modes depending on the range of the lifetime. If the lifetime is very long, in the order of 100 microseconds or longer, it is most accurate to use the transient mode. In the transient mode, the equation for the effective carrier lifetime is simplified by setting the generation rate to zero, which is achieved by using a very short flash. This reduces the expression to the following form. The intensity of the flash is in the order of 30 to 35 suns and has a duration shorter than 0.5 milliseconds. A typical flash will generate a charge carrier density in the order of 10 to the power of 16 per cubic centimeter. The time-resolved excess carrier density decay is calculated from the photoconductance measurement. The effective carrier lifetime is then determined from the charge carrier density decay curve, which starts right after the flash, such that the generation rate is indeed zero. The shape of the decay curve looks exponential, but is actually the result of many different recombination mechanisms acting at the same time, all having their characteristic lifetime. The second mode, which is used for cells or wafers with a shorter charge carrier lifetime, is the quasi-steady-state mode. In this mode, the flash duration is much longer than the carrier lifetime. Therefore, the generation rate will be much larger than d delta n over dt, such that the expression is simplified like is shown here. The characteristic decay time of the flash is in the order of 2 to 4 milliseconds, while the light intensity is detected by a calibrated photodiode that is embedded in the stage next to the wafer. Again, the time resolve excess carrier density decay is calculated from the photoconductance measurement, but now it is simply divided by the generation rate to obtain the effective minority carrier lifetime. A typical way of presenting the effective minority carrier lifetime is to plot it versus the minority carrier density, resulting in a graph like is shown here. The actual value for tau f is then often taken at a minority carrier density of 1 times 10 to the power of 15 per cubic centimeter, which is a typical carrier density under Wonsan illumination. The effective minority carrier lifetime in this sample would then be 1.7 milliseconds. From the lifetime measurement on different structures, several quantities can be derived that give information on the recombination rate in the structures. The first quantity is the saturation current density J0. The expression below can be derived when we assume that the carrier density is reasonably homogeneous as a function of position in the device, implying that the surface recombination velocity is low. For that case, the effective lifetime varies nearly linearly with excess carrier density, and the slope of this variation is proportional to the saturation current density J0. The second quantity is the so-called implied VOC. This quantity can simply be calculated when knowing the carrier density at one sun illumination using this equation. Note that this implied VOC is not the same as the VOC of the solar cell, as this photoconductance measurement discussed here does not take voltage losses in the cell into account. Taking a lifetime measurement is very quick. This is demonstrated in the following video. Here we see a typical lifetime measurement system manufactured by Sinton Instruments. A crystalline silicon wafer is placed in the center of the stage, directly located above the coil. A high-intensity flash illuminates the wafer, and the measurement is taken in a few milliseconds. In summary, we have discussed how the effective minority carrier lifetime is a measure for the recombination rate and thereby the quality of bulk material and how well the surface is passivated. We have demonstrated the methodology of a lifetime measurement and that it is determined through the decay of the charge carrier density after excitation, which in turn is calculated from a photoconductance measurement. We have shown the difference between the transient and quasi-steady state operating modes, which is selected based on the range of the effective minority carrier lifetime. And finally, we have discussed that from the lifetime measurement, we can derive the saturation current density J0 and the implied VOC.